Amen. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the Foundry, whether you're joining us in person or online. This is the Foundry, where we're all about a better you and a better world. And my name is Seth, and I am glad you're here. Welcome to 2021. Yeah, you made it. Don't you feel different? Thank God. Isn't everything fixed? Everything's fine now? Your bank accounts are full after Christmas? Diseases have gone away? Injuries are healed? No? Okay. I'm really excited about this series that we're calling The Gospel According to John. New year, new series, and what we're going to be doing over the next 6 weeks is we're going to be looking at the life and the music of the one and only Mr. Johnny Cash. And the idea is, yeah. So all of my 60-plus people will be really happy about it. No, I think most people have at least some sort of acknowledgement or understanding or appreciation for who he was and what he did. And what's going to be cool is as we go through this, you'll get to see more and more, like, the stuff that he was about really is incredible. So we're going to be looking at his life and kind of connecting it to our life, the good, the bad, the ups, the down, the highs, the lows, and then we're going to be connecting that to the gospel, the good news that is the message of Jesus. So it's going to be good. I hope that you will make plans to be here for the next 6 weeks or so and follow along with us. So in 2005, there was a movie that came out called Walk the Line. If you remember this, did you see this? Yeah, great movie. There was a lot of hype surrounding this movie concerning the life and times of Johnny Cash. Johnny himself, you know, like, that's a little technically before my time, but my dad has a big appreciation, a big love of Johnny Cash. And so growing up, I was familiar with the songs, and as I've gotten older, I've developed that same love of Johnny Cash. So in 2005, this movie came out, Walk the Line. It was Joaquin Phoenix played Johnny, and Reese Witherspoon, the American sweetheart, she played June Carter, did a great job, fantastic movie. I would recommend, if you haven't seen it, and want to get caught up on, like, kind of his life and how it goes, it's a great movie to watch. Check it out, you know, this week. Come tell me what you think. Now, when that movie came out, 2005, so 16 years ago, feels like it was just yesterday, right? You're getting older. Because I know my dad's a huge fan, I thought, you know what? Dad, let's go opening night and watch the show. Okay, now this would have been a big deal. Like, there was a lot of hype around the movie, but my dad doesn't go to the theater very often. And he definitely doesn't go, like, opening night. My dad waits till a movie gets to, like, streaming and Redbox or whatever, and then he waits again till it gets out of that and gets on network television, and then he watches the edited network television with commercials version of the movie. So he's always, like, a couple years behind on his movie watching. So I thought, you know what, this will be a big treat. We'll have some father-son bonding time. Johnny Cash will be men. We'll go to the theater opening night. It'll be a great time. I said, Dad, let's go to the movies. I'll buy the tickets. He said, sure. So we go. We drive on the way there. He's singing Johnny Cash. We get there. There's about four showings of the same movie, like, every 15 minutes, right? So the theater is packed. The line is coming out of the theater, around the building. We get parked. We stand in line. My dad's singing Johnny Cash. We get into the line to get popcorn and sodas. My dad's singing Johnny Cash. We get into the theater. We're sitting down with our popcorn and our drinks. My dad's singing Johnny Cash. The movie starts, and my dad begins a running commentary of the movie, and I'm like, can I just watch the show? Like, you've been singing. He's so pumped. He's so excited about this whole thing. Can't contain himself. And so it's like just giving me backstory, and I'm like, let me watch them. I want to watch them. Like, I need you to settle down. And then, like, as he's starting to, like, write and make up songs, and my dad is singing the songs that he's working on making up as we're in the movie, and I'm like, Dad, you have to chill out. And then finally, the scene where he plays his, like, first big show comes, and so Joaquin Phoenix walks onto the stage, and he says the very famous line of, "Hello, I'm Johnny Cash." And my dad's repeating it as it's happening, and then he launches into the first song, which I believe was I Walk the Line, and so my dad starts singing in the theater, and he's smacking his, and tapping his foot, and I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I'm like, Dad, you have to chill out. He keeps going and going. I'm like, Dad, I'm serious. If you don't stop, I am going to get up and leave. I'm going to walk to go stand in the aisle and or something because I paid to see him sing it, and all these people around us, they want to hear him sing it. They didn't pay to hear Scott Cain sing the movie in the theater. I need you to chill out. So we calmed down for a minute. My frustration only served to fuel my father. So the next song begins. It starts going, and my dad looks at me, and he smiles, and I look at him, and I go, and then he elbows me, and he takes off into the very next song, laughing and singing with much delight. He just couldn't contain himself. He couldn't help the excitement. So as the movie goes, if you're not familiar with it, I need to give you some details, a little bit of it, and because that's where we gotta get through this to get to the song today. The movie talks about this. You can see it for yourself, but just some highlights. Okay, so Johnny Cash, born in the 1930s in Arkansas. His father was a poor cotton... Arkansas. Did you just clap? Did somebody clap for Arkansas? He grows up, his father is a poor cotton farmer, so Johnny helped the family by spending a lot of times picking cotton, much of his life spent in the field picking cotton. He's often talked about the scars on his hands that was left from that cotton. Somewhere around the age of 12 or 13, he lost his older brother, Jack, in a tragic accident at a sawmill. This was very difficult for him. He carried a lot of guilt with this for a long time, had a profound impact and effect on his life. From a young age, he was always interested in music, was very much about gospel music. In fact, he had this like deep-seated belief or idea that he would one day grow up to either be like a preacher of some sort or a gospel recording artist. As he got a little bit older, by the time he turned 18, around 1950, he signed up for service for the military. This was on the outset of the Korean War. He served 4 years in the Air Force in Germany as a Morse code operator. In 1954, 4 years later, he came home. He was honorably discharged, came back to the States. Him and his wife, Vivian, moved to Memphis, Tennessee, where he began to sell appliances. He got a job selling appliances at a store. He wasn't very good at it, apparently, but he would do that by day, and then at night, he would play music with some buddies. He met two guys by the name of Luther Perkins and Marshall... What's his name? Huh? Marshall Grant? Hold on. Let me get this straight. I want to give these guys some credit here. Yeah, Marshall Grant. Luther Perkins and Marshall Grant. These two guys later became the Tennessee Two, like his band, essentially. And then in 1955, a year later, he was able to get his foot in the door at Sun Records with a guy named Sam Phillips, and he ended up recording and releasing an album that same year, 1955. So he was with Sun Records and Sam Phillips for about 3 years. At this time, three years before he moved to Columbia Records and made the big time. But during those 3 years at Sun Records, he did, he gained a great deal of fame and notoriety. His songs were getting popular. People were beginning to find out who he was. He was making a lot more money, and things were going quite well for him musically. But along with like the rise in fame and the extra stuff he was getting, he had like stress levels that were rising up at home. His wife wanted to live a quiet, simple kind of life, and Johnny wanted to be recording, playing music, playing bigger and bigger shows. And so as he began to gain notoriety and fame, his wife became more concerned with his faithfulness to her, right? She had seen guys like Elvis and how girls were flocking to Elvis, throwing themselves to Elvis, and was concerned that this would be a problem for her husband as well. So in response to her growing concern about his faithfulness to her, he wrote this song, okay? The song called I Walk the Line. You may be familiar with it. So I want to kind of read through the lyrics of I Walk the Line. So in case you don't know it, you'll see. And if you do know it and don't know what it's about, this is why he originally wrote it. So let's take a look at this. He says, I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ins out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. Again, to his wife, who's worried about him being faithful to her. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day is through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you. because you're mine, I walk the line. As sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind both day and night, and happiness I've known proves that it's right, because you're mine, I walk the line. You've got a way to keep me on your side. You give me cause for love that I can't hide. For you, I know I'd even try to turn the tide, because you're mine, I walk the line. So he writes this song to Vivian as a way to like give her this sense of loyalty to her. Now, when he originally writes this song, he had written this as like a very slow kind of love ballad, romantic profession of faith and loyalty to his wife. All right, so it was supposed to be slow and emotional. But when he was recording it, Sam Phillips at Sun Records kept pushing him, hey, I want you to play it up tempo. He refused to do it. They kept going through the slow version. Eventually, they came to the end of their recording session, and Sam pushed him one more time, can you do one up-tempo version for me just for fun? Okay, so they do it, they record it. So Johnny Cash assumes that Sam Phillips will release the slow, romantic version to his wife, and it's not until he heard the song on the radio for the first time that he realized that Sam Phillips pulled a fast one. That Sam Phillips released the up-tempo version. This, of course, made him very upset, very angry, until he realized like how much of a success that song had become. He got over the anger pretty quick. In fact, this song became one of his many great, great hits. Now, here's what's even more interesting about this song, at least I think, is that Johnny wanted to be a gospel recording artist. Sam Phillips wanted him to be rock and roll, didn't want to mess with the religious stuff very much. In an interview a couple of months before he died, Johnny Cash said this about this song. He said, Sam never knew it, but I Walked the Line was my first gospel hit. So Sam Phillips pulled a fast one on Johnny, putting the up-tempo version on the radio, making it a hit. But yet Johnny Cash pulled a fast one on Sam Phillips, making this kind of a gospel, he believed this to be a gospel song. So it was intended to be a ballad for Vivian, but the song had this whole second layer of meaning for Johnny that had to do with not just his faithfulness to his wife, but his faithfulness to God as well. Robert Hilburn said this about the song. He said, it's an expression of spiritual and romantic allegiance. So it's this multi-layered thing, spiritual and romantic allegiance. If you're familiar with Johnny Cash and you know anything about his life, you know he had all kinds of struggles all throughout his life. He struggled with faithfulness to his wife. He struggled with faithfulness to God. He struggled with drug addiction, mainly pills. He struggled with depression. He struggled with self-destructive behavior. Merle Haggard, there's a good quote from Merle Haggard that said this about Johnny Cash and specifically this song, in light of all his struggles. He said, Johnny Cash was out of line all his life. I Walked the Line was kind of ludicrous for him to sing. He never walked any line. What's this guy singing that song for? He doesn't even know lines exist. What's he doing? But see, herein, to me, lies the intersection of his story and our story, right? Johnny couldn't walk the line. He struggled to walk the line. He struggled with faithfulness to God. He struggled with depression and self-doubt and all these things. And I think many of us, if we were honest, we can relate to that, struggling to walk the line, struggling to do the right things. We may, no matter how hard we try sometimes, try to do the right thing, but then we still fail from time to time. The good news that is the gospel that is the underlying story of the entirety of the scripture is that the gospel message, it really isn't about our ability to be faithful to God. The underlying message of the Bible is about God's faithfulness to us. Now, in the Hebrew scriptures, there's this word, we've talked about this before, it may sound familiar, this word, it's the word hesed. This word hesed is the word that's used to describe God's faithfulness, his loyalty, his fidelity. It's this deep sense of faithfulness, kindness, and fidelity. If you want to understand like who God is and the nature of God, understanding the idea of Hesed is important, because essentially this idea of Hesed is, it's kind of like God's way of saying, I walk the line to us. Okay, so now stay with me. In the Old Testament, there's a couple different covenants. Two of the major ones that I want to talk to you about. Okay, the first one, not in any particular order. The first one is the covenant that's made between God and the people at Mount Sinai. God takes the people out of slavery. They've been there for 400 years. He brings them to Mount Sinai. He meets with them at the mountain, and then he gives them what we would call the law, the Ten Commandments. They establish this covenant. The thing about this covenant that God establishes with the people, he says, I will be your God and you will be my people. But this covenant is entirely, it's conditional. It's like reward and consequence. You know, okay? In fact, Moses talks about this in Deuteronomy chapter something. In Deuteronomy chapter 10, chapter 30, I want to read this to you, verse 15, and watch how Moses speaks about this covenant, because it describes this like reward and consequence type of system. He says, see, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you will certainly be destroyed. No pressure. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live. I've set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Basically, if you're faithful to God, there will be blessing and reward. And if you stray, if you are unfaithful to God, there will be curses and destruction. It's kind of like walk the line or else. Which really, from what I've seen in a lot of people, this is how most people understand the nature of God. But as the story of Johnny goes on and as the story of Israel goes on, what you see with Israel is that they've struggled ultimately to walk the line. They're not able to be fully faithful to God. Their hearts are all over the place. They keep honoring and worshiping other gods. And as a nation, they are not faithful to God. And the consequence ends up being what's called the exile. And the exile, we've talked about a little bit, is this devastating thing that happens to the people. They're taken from their land. They're under the oppression of a foreign nation. This time we're talking about Babylon. And what you see happening during the exile is when the Babylonians come in, they wipe out the temple. The temple is a dwelling place of God. So now they're concerned about where is God in all of this. We've lost our God. We've lost our connection to God. And then they're taken from their land, and their land was considered to be a direct connection to the very promises of God. So the two things that they seem to hang their identity on, the presence of God and the promises of God, have now been taken from them. So the exile is a huge deal in the lives of Israel and how they understand and how they identify themselves. They failed to walk the line, and there was this consequence. The good news here, and where I think we can ascertain a great deal of hope and encouragement and comfort, is that before the covenant at Sinai between God and the nation of Israel, there's a covenant before that. And it's a covenant between God and Abram before he becomes Abraham. And this covenant between God and Abram, it's like a whole different thing. There's this whole different dynamic. We get a whole different picture of what God is like. This is a covenant that God himself establishes, he initiates, God vows to uphold. And it's in this covenant that we see this like unconditional grace of God. Okay, so let's look at this. Genesis chapter 15, if you want to turn there and read, or we'll show some up here. God and Abram are having this conversation. God says, I will be your reward. Abraham says, cool. Abram says, that's great, but the problem is I can't have any kids, and so all of my inheritance is going to go to like a servant in my household. Like, so what can you basically, like, I need something more or something? And so God talks to him, and he makes this promise in verse 4. He says, it says this, then the word of the Lord came to him, this man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. Then he took him outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. So Abram's like, look, that's cool, but also, like, what about this thing? And God's like, okay, you're worried about that? I'm going to give you this promise. You will have as many descendants as the stars, right? The other part of that promise is he talks about, I will make you into a great nation. This is all part of this promise. So you'll have this lineage and descendant that will be plentiful. The story continues, verse 6. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. He also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? Again, so here's he's been given a promise of descendants and becoming a nation, and then he's given the promise of having his own land, which why, again, the exile would have been so difficult. The story continues. So Abraham says, how will I know I will receive this promise? Verse 9, so the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abraham brought all these to him. He cut them in two, arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Now, this seems weird. I'll talk about it in a second, but it's a weird thing that's happening. Like, he's cutting animals in half. I don't, what's going on? He goes into this sleep, and then God gives him this vision, and it's a vision for what will happen to his life, and it's a vision for what will happen to, like, his descendants as they're becoming a nation. And then in verse 17, it says, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, Kenizzites, Kadmonites, Hittites, Perizzites, Rephaites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites. So I'm going to give you this land. Here's the promise. So now let me explain a little bit about this. It seems weird, right? How can I know I'm going to possess, how can I know that you're going to be good on your promise? How do I know that you'll be faithful to your promise? God says, well, get a ram, a goat, and a bull, and, like, bring them here. What was it? The heifer, a goat, and a ram. Bring them here, cut them in half, and then lay them side by side. Okay, now, what you have to understand at this time and in this place, there was a particular practice that they would use in order to establish a covenant or a deal. In fact, this was not an uncommon practice. And what they would do is, if you entered into some sort of agreement with somebody, the way that you would finalize, the way you would make that a bit more concrete, is that you would take an animal and cut it in half, and then you would place the pieces side by side, and then each person that's a part of that deal, that's a part of whatever agreement you've made, would walk between the pieces. Okay, so what you have to remember, you have to think about, you've got the animals here, blood, guts, whatever. I don't know how much space they gave them. I don't, you know. Anyways, there'd be this pool of blood, and then they would walk through it to the other side. And when each party walked through it to the other side, this agreement was settled. And the idea was that if either of you broke this agreement, this would be your fate. So it's kind of a big deal, right? It's kind of a, I mean, this is it seems to be a bit more than a handshake, right? This is pretty intense. So what's fascinating about this is that I want to reread verse 17 and 18. Oh, by the way, some scholars also suggest that this practice might be where we get the phrase to cut a deal. Like, you've heard that phrase, we cut a deal. Well, where does that come from? Well, because they used to literally cut animals in half and walk this bloody path, and that's how they made the deal finalized. It's a trivia question. Trivia night, you'll get it. Don't worry about it. So let's read verse 6, 17, and 18. And I want you to see, because there's something that happens in this part that makes this particular deal exceptional. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch, I mean, that's pretty cool anyways. That's not the part I'm talking about, though. Appeared and passed between the two pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said to your descendants, I will give this land. Do you see it? Okay, so in a normal binding agreement, when they establish this practice, when they cut a deal, both parties would walk the path between the animals. But here, only God walks the path, and Abram does not. You see, at Sinai, God makes this conditional covenant with Israel. They have to agree to uphold their end of the deal, or else. Reward and consequence. But here, in God's covenant with Abram, God alone walks the path. This whole thing is completely one-sided. The covenant is entirely the product, it is entirely God's responsibility and entirely the product of God's hasid. Loyalty, commitment, fidelity, faithfulness. God is walking the line for him. Right? This to me, like, this is unreal. This is a huge deal. This is like, wait, what? This is almost hard to comprehend that God is just assuming responsibility for both sides of the deal. He's taking all of it upon himself. And depending on how you think of the nature of God or how you've been taught to think about the nature of God, this may even be hard for us to wrap our finite minds around. This covenant shines a spotlight on the depth of the hasid of God, this incredibly deep faithfulness and kindness and fidelity of God to his creation. Yes, later on in the other covenant, there's this reward and consequence system. There's this you might get what you deserve, but that's never the end of the story, because the covenant before that covenant at Sinai is about God taking the responsibility. Yes, Israel was unfaithful and suffered the consequence of exile, but their story wasn't done. Their story wasn't over. God has taken responsibility for them. So even though they may have felt like all was lost in the exile, underneath the pain, the hurt, and the consequence was the hasid of God, the faithfulness and loyalty of God. This is not the end. And God will continue to remain faithful to them even when they are not faithful to him. What an incredible picture of the nature of who God is. What a beautiful story. What a beautiful picture. For many, it seems like we have this idea, this picture, this one picture of God that seems to be like my way or the highway. Do this or else. If you don't follow, be prepared to suffer the consequence. And the part we seem to have missed is the underlying faithfulness of God. Like, I mean, and really, to me, isn't this like what you might even call an amazing kind of grace? This is the thing that should give us a great deal of hope each and every day. This is the thing that we should be grateful for, that we should be confident in, that even though I wrestle and I struggle and I fail, God does not. And God is faithful always. There's this time that Johnny Cash was talking about some of his times of darkness and depression. And he was talking about how he'd been through this like self-destructive behavior and this spiritual rebellion. And I want you to watch what he says. He says, "The times when I was so down and out of it were also the times when I felt the presence of God. I felt that presence, that positive power saying to me, I'm still here. I'm still here. That's the Hesed of God. That's the gospel message. That's the good news that no matter what, God says, I'm still here for you. I have come for you. I'm taking responsibility for you. I am walking the line. I am walking the path for you. God says, because you are mine, I walk the line. So whatever you've been through this past year, whatever you may be still carrying, the weight, the burden, the anxiety, the fear, whatever, and then whatever this next year may hold, the year 2021, I think we take hope in this new year in knowing and trusting that God is faithful, that God in the book of Genesis walks the line for Abram, and God through sending his son has walked the line for you. And to me, that's the gospel according to John. Now, we're gonna do our moment of communion. We're gonna participate in this sacred meal of common union. But before we do that, I wanna take some time to do something else, right? So the ushers will come in a minute. They'll pass the body and the blood, the bread and the juice. They'll pass these emblems to us that remind us of God's faithfulness to us, that remind us of God's love for us, that invite us into this deeper connection to his faithfulness. So we're going to take that. But before we do that, I'm going to ask Joe to come. He's going to play this song. He's going to play Walk the Line, but he's going to do it in a slow way, maybe the way that Johnny had originally played it. And I want you to take this time to think through this song, to frame it in a lens in one of two ways. Maybe for you, you've wrestled with where is God. Maybe you're struggling to see where is he in your life. Is he ahead of me? Maybe what you need to hear today and be encouraged by is being reminded that God loves you and being reminded that God is faithful to you. So maybe you need to listen to the song as God's singing it to you. Like, because you're his, he's going to take care of you. Maybe today things are okay with you. And really, you're in a place of gratitude and appreciation that God has been faithful to you. And so maybe you want to listen to this song as if it's you singing to God. That because God has been faithful to me, I want to be faithful to him. And so maybe for you, this just becomes a worship song. But either way, whether you want to picture it as God singing to you or you singing to God, I want you just to sit and allow this song that you may be familiar with, you may not be, you may be overly familiar with, but as we play it in this slow way, to let it take a new form and to let it resonate within you in a new way. And then once Joe's done with that, we will go into our time of communion.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the end out for the tie that binds, because you're mine. I walk the line. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day's through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you, because you're mine. I walk the line. Sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind, both happiness I've known proves that it's right, because you're mine. I walk the line. You've got a way to keep me on your side. You give me cause for love that I can't hide. For you I know I'd even try to turn the tide, because you're mine. I walk the line. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds, because you're mine. I walk the line, because you're mine. I walk the line. God, we are so grateful. We're so thankful that you walk the line for us. God, in this moment, we thank you for Jesus. We acknowledge our dependence on you. We rejoice in the death and resurrection of Jesus that allows us to be brought back into a relationship with you. And so, God, right now, as we meditate, as we reflect, as we commune, just pray that you would draw our hearts, draw our minds, draw our attention to what it is that you need us to hear and see and understand today. In Jesus' name, amen.